Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome. Today we'll be looking at the topic Christ on the cross and in the heart. Christ on the cross and in the heart. These are the two critical main works of the Lord towards us as human beings, towards man. We'll be looking at his work on the cross, not in full detail, and also in the heart. Two critical locations as it relates to the destiny of every man. So the cross represents the work of Christ for us. That is what he did, and as the Lamb of God, as the brazen serpent, as the seed of the woman, as the last Adam, different titles which we will go to in a few pages, because he had to do that to redeem us back to God. He had to do that to purchase us from the kingdom of darkness and bring us to his own kingdom. The heart represents the work of Christ in us, so what he's doing today. So this is historical, what he did on the cross, but the power and the effect are still speaking till today and till eternity. But the work of the heart is right now on the surface of the earth, in the heart of every of his believers. So he finished this work on the cross of Calvary over 2,000 years ago, while the work on the heart is continuously going on in the heart of every of his saints, building us, transforming us, sanctifying us. The cross is God's word. So the cross is focused towards God, because man sinned against God. We all sinned in Adam. When Adam fell in the transgression, we inherited that baggage and that liability. So the cross was mainly to take care of the God word side. That is to redeem us back to God, to reconcile us to God, to make us, turn us from enemies of God to children of God, to bring us, to quicken us from the dead, to translate us from the kingdom of darkness to his dear kingdom. Then the heart is manward in the sense that that's actually the focus is on us, because right now he's building us up, he's transforming us, he's sanctifying us, he's edifying us, he's conforming us to his glorious image. So these are two critical areas, the cross and the heart. And as we go ahead, we also see as well that the heart is a receptacle for Christ. So the heart of man was created as a receptacle, like our stomach is a receptacle for food. The heart was created to contain God. The heart was created to contain Christ. The heart is a receptacle where God dwells in. That's why I said in the Old Testament that he will give us a new heart. He will take the heart of the stony heart away and give us the heart of flesh, because the heart is the dwelling place of God. That's where God longs to be. And the cross and the heart are two great altars. I think they are the greatest altars on the earth. The cross is an altar. An altar, we could define an altar as a point of contact between the earth and the heavens, or the spiritual, the physical and the spiritual, a point of contact whereby we change what is going on in the realm of the spirit from the physical. The cross is an altar. Though it was happening physically on the earth here, but the work and the effect translates the earth here even to the realm of the spirit. Same with the heart. The heart is a very sacred altar, because the heart is where God longs to dwell. Wherever God dwells ultimately represents the greatest altar you can find. So these are two critical places that the Lord Jesus Christ wants to, that he did. This is in his earthly ministry. This is in his ascension, in his heavenly ministry. He's in the heavens, and at the same time, he's in our hearts. Very mysterious, but we'll look at some of the scripture as we go on. So we said earlier on, these are two critical ministries of the Lord, Christ on the cross and Christ on the heart. The Christ on the cross and the Christ on the heart. Someone might ask, are these two different Christ you're bringing to us? No, they are not two different Christ. It's still the same Christ. It's the same yesterday and today and forever. But he went through different processes, different things, and which we will go into as well. Of course, the scripture tells us that the word became flesh. The word became flesh. When something becomes, that means it's going through a process. And the word that became flesh, or in 1 Timothy 3:16, that God was manifest in the flesh. So God became a man in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ, with the ultimate goal of going to the cross to crucify the flesh, to redeem man back into himself, and also through the cross to defeat the enemy. We're not going too much into the crucifixion ministry of the Lord, but this is a great work that the Lord did for us on the cross. So we're looking at from the historical Christ to the present Christ. So on the cross, when he said it is finished, that was the work of redemption. That was his earthly ministry. So that is the historical Christ, the Christ that lived on the surface of the earth for about 33 and a half years. Yes, he died, but he's still the same one that resurrected, but in an ascended state, the Lord's Spirit, which we go to some of the titles that he also has. Looking ahead as well, these are his earthly and his heavenly ministry. So the Christ on the cross is his earthly ministry. The Christ in the heart is his heavenly ministry. from the Christ in the flesh to the Christ as the Spirit. Very mysterious, because it's the Word that became flesh that tabernacled among us and we beheld His glory. And also is the same last Adam, because the First Corinthians 15:45b tells us that the first Adam became a living soul. The last Adam, who is Christ, became a life-giving spirit. Now the Lord is the Spirit, 2 Corinthians 3:17. So from the Christ in the cross, so you can see the different stages and processes that He went through, going by scriptures. Yes, from eternity past He was immortal, but He made Himself to become a man. He came in the likeness of man so as to redeem us. And from the Christ in the flesh to the Christ in the Spirit, from the outward Christ, which was, we see an account of this in the four Gospels, to the indwelling Christ. So it's no longer just an outward Christ to us believers, His saints, His the members of His body, but it's an indwelling Christ, an inward Christ. So we have Him as our life, and a lot of the scriptures, some of the scriptures we go through in few pages. So from the outward Christ to the indwelling Christ. Also, we look at Him from the Christ from eternity past. So these are different, I don't want to call them, they are not different Christ, but this is the same Christ going through the same, going through different processes. So we could say that there was a Christ from eternity past, because in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So from eternity past is without beginning, just like it, Melchizedek was said, it's like Him that has no beginning and He has no end. So from, we can say that the Christ from eternity past to the Christ, the incarnated Christ, which we see in the four Gospels when He became flesh, that is when He came as the seed of the woman. And we also have Him being in his incarnated state. He lived on the earth for 3.5 years. Then at the end of that human living, He became the crucified Christ. That is the Christ that is on the cross, that paid the price. He was paying the price as the Lamb of God, as the ultimate sacrifice, the author of eternal salvation. And from Him being crucified, we go to the resurrected Christ. That is the Christ that resurrected. You know, when He resurrected, He said that they should touch Him, that the Spirit has no flesh, and very mystical and mysterious appearance, you will say, because he came in through where the disciples were, but wasn't even through the door. So the resurrected Christ now being the Spirit, because we are now told upon His resurrection, now the Lord is the Spirit. The glorified Christ on the cross, the glorified Christ is now, so we have the resurrected Christ that stayed with the disciples for about 40 days after His resurrection. He was teaching them about the kingdom of God. You can see an account of this from the latter side of John 20. And also, if you go into Acts chapter 1 as well, the account was given there where He was appearing and disappearing. He was making His presence visible and invisible. He was telling them a lot of things that was going to come into pass. And when He now ascended into the heaven, so a lot of other things happened. We see an account of this in Revelation. He was made Lord and Christ. Also, is in Acts chapter 2. He was made Lord and Christ. He was made the author of eternal salvation, the great high priest, our advocate, the ruler of the kings of the earth, the first begotten from the dead. So what a great picture of the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the mystery of God. And that's why Paul said, I count all things but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. So He is from the last Adam to the life-giving Spirit. The last Adam to end the old creation. Adam is the first Adam. Christ is the last Adam. In the eyes of God, as the last Adam, He ends the old creation and He becomes the second man. That is to start the new creation. So from the last Adam to the life-giving Spirit, the last Adam became a life-giving Spirit upon His resurrection. Because whatever you sow, the seed is not in the fruit form. And if you look at 1 Corinthians 15, you will see the Holy Spirit saying that if you sow anything in corruption, it is reaping in corruption. If you sow it in weakness, it is reaping power. If you sow in dishonor, it's reaping. If you sow in dishonor, it's reaping honor. It's a picture. And now it now says that now the Lord, that the first Adam was made a living soul, the last Adam became a life-giving spirit. So Christ on the cross delivered us out of Egypt. Egypt is a type of the kingdom of darkness, and you know the Old Testament is a picture. It's almost like you want to call it type shadows of what was going on in the reality. Reality is in the New Testament. There are pictures. The reality is in the New Testament. So Christ on the cross delivered us out of Egypt, similar to what God told Moses that they should put a serpent. When snakes were biting the Israelites in the wilderness, He said they should put a brazen snake on the rod and should hang it, and whoever looks upon it was saved. And the Lord Jesus Christ actually referred to that, I think in John chapter 3, when He said the Son of Man as well would be raised up in the air, just like Moses raised up the rod. So Christ on the cross delivered us out of Egypt. That's the negative side of our let's say our God's judicial redemption. Now the positive side, having redeemed us from the kingdom of darkness, he didn't redeem us for us to go live our life to do whatever we want to do. It's with the purpose to come inside of us and to walk his good pleasure through us. So Christ in the heart brings us to the promised land, which is the holiest of all. Our promised land is not a physical land, in my own opinion, as believers. Our promised land is the very presence of God, who is actually Christ himself. So just like the Israelites were sojourning from the Egypt, they were delivered from the land of bondage and they were taken to a Canaan land. That was a type, that is a picture. The reality of that Canaan land is the holiest of all. That is the very Shekinah presence of God. That's why I said in John 14 that I'm going and I'm coming to bring you to where I am. He also prayed for this in John 17, that where I am, that they may be with me also. Where was he? He is in the Father. So he brings us into the Father, the very presence of God. So Christ in the heart brings us into the promised land, which is the holiest of all. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us. So the cross was a means to an end. The cross is not an end in itself, but is a means to an end. His destination was the heart of man. The destination of the Lord, all he was doing was the very heart. He longed to be in the heart of man. It was the heart of man. He created the heart of man as a receptacle for him to dwell, to live in. So he would take nothing. He would stop at nothing. That's why when we crossed into the New Testament, God made it unequivocally clear that he had only one agenda. The agenda was to get into the very life of man, to be the life of man. John 10:10 says, the thief cometh to kill, to steal, and to destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. So he came to become our very life. And how is he going to do that? Going to be the heart of man. That's why he had to give us a new heart. So he went to the cross to pave the way into man's heart. So the cross was a channel, was a path, was a medium for him to get into our heart. He could not get into our heart except he went through the cross. John 12:24 says that except the grain of wheat falls to the ground and die, it abides by itself, but if it dies, it produces many grain. So he had to go as the grain of wheat to die as that seed, and now to resurrect in a form, in the spirit, you want to call it the Lord being the spirit, to now dwell in our hearts, into the spirit of man. What a joy for what the Lord has done. So Christ on the cross is the Lamb of God. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. Is the seed of the woman. God promised in Genesis 3 that the seed of the woman would come, that would bruise the head of the serpent. Is the last Adam, being the last Adam, that he ends the old creation. Is the only begotten Son of God, that is totally divinity. It was upon his resurrection he became the first begotten Son of God. So you can see it from two angles. The only begotten Son of God, that is the only begotten. The only begotten means the only, there's no second. But upon his death and resurrection, he became the firstborn Son of God, the first begotten from the dead. Now we are now his many brothers. That's how we actually became children of God, sons and daughters of the Most High. It was through him, because we were in him, in the eyes of God, even while he was on the cross of Calvary. Because God said that we ate the fruit with Adam. He didn't say it directly, but indirectly, because we suffered with Adam, because we were in Adam in the old creation. Now that Christ has come to redeem us, we were also in Christ. So that's why we go through baptism, that we can be related to his death. That's why Paul said, I've been crucified with Christ. So is the Christ in the four gospels. So the greater part of the four gospels, that's the Christ we see, that the judicial redemption, that is the as the Lamb of God, as the seed of the woman, he destroyed the devil as the seed of the woman. Hebrews 2:2 says, he through death destroyed him that had the power over death. He is the last Adam to end the old creation, the only begotten Son of God, who now became the first begotten Son of God from the dead upon his resurrection, and Christ in the four gospels. So the Christ in the heart is the life-giving spirit. That is the spirit of Christ, the spirit of Jesus Christ, the spirit of God's Son. Galatians 4:6, that the spirit of God's Son, that we cry Abba, by which we cry Abba Father. So what a joy for what he became upon his resurrection. That's why he even called himself the Spirit in Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 3. The Lord called himself the Spirit 7 different times. What a joy. The first begotten from the dead. It's a mystery, the mystery of the Godhead, the Father, the Son, the Spirit. We've done a different teaching on that, we're only limited by the extent to which the Lord shows, though it's a great mystery. 1 John 5:7 says that there are three that bear records in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. These three are one. It's a great mystery. God, the triune God, is composed of three persons. If I use that word carefully, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit. How do you divide? Are they in different separate prayer? I don't think I would dare go into that area. It's very mysterious. It's beyond what human brain can comprehend, because God uses plural and singular for himself. He calls himself we. He also calls himself I. He said, let us make man in our own image. And in another place, he said, hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is one. Are they three? Are they one? Just that's why the church fathers came up with the term the Trinity, the triune God. The God that is three in one, 1 John 5:7. There are three that bear record, but they are one. How are they? I think that is beyond what any human being can comprehend. But the joy of it is that the Trinity, we can confidently say that we are members of the family of God. So it's the first begotten from the dead. That is from the dead upon his resurrection. He had to go through the death period as a grain of wheat to resurrect, to produce us the new creation. He's the head of the new creation, that is the Christ in the hearts today. And he has a lot of titles beyond this, but of course, for lack of time, we can't put it, and we are only limited by what the Lord shows to us. Also, as the Christ on the cross, is also the serpent in form. I think that was the page before this. The serpent in form, it was a man in the flesh. Now the Christ in the heart is the head of the new creation. He's a great high priest. A great account of this we see in the book of Hebrews. As a great high priest, he's taking care of us for the church, he's interceding for us, he's ministering God into our life. Christ from Acts to Revelation. So the Christ from Acts to Revelation represent the Christ upon his resurrected in his ascended state, the Spirit of Christ, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, the Spirit of God, so the Spirit of the Son of God. So we now go ahead and look at that, some of the scriptures of the Christ that is living in our heart. Ephesians chapter 3, that he will grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might through his Spirit in the inner man, that we will, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. That is Christ dwelling in our hearts through faith. That is God's ultimate desire and purpose for us, as he's saying that Christ is the one living in us. So we take this as a prayer, I think from verse 16-17, that he will dwell in our hearts through faith. So the heart of man is where God longs to dwell. That is where Christ longs to be. So here's Colossians chapter 1. To them, God will to make known what are the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. That is, the mystery God had hidden from eternity, from ages past, is that the Lord Jesus Christ is living in us. And what a joy that in this dispensation of the New Testament, the Lord himself is living in our heart. That's why I said, I am the vine, you are the vine. Abide in me and I in you. Him we preach. That's why we preach him, because he's the very one, no longer just on the cross, no longer on the cross. He's no longer on the cross. He's now in our heart. It doesn't mean that the cross is insignificant. No. The cross is very significant to our Christian life. That is the life. That is the blood that redeemed us. We still thank him for that. But just like the angels in Luke 24, as they told the disciples, why are you seeking for the living among the dead? He's alive. He's risen and he's in our hearts today. So what a joy toward the Lord. So looking at some other scripture, this is 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Since you seek for a proof of Christ speaking in me, who is not weak towards you, but mighty in you. So here is Paul saying to the church in Corinth, why are you looking for the proof of Christ in me? He's not weak. It's not just me as a pastor, as a minister, as an apostle, as whatever you want to call it, but he's also mighty in you. Even if you call yourself the least in the kingdom, that Christ is mighty in every one of us. Of course, the function to which we can manifest him probably depends on the knowledge that we have that is in us. Someone could have light, or light could be connected to a building, but if you don't know where the light switch is, darkness might still prevail. So that's why maybe Paul was praying that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened, to know the hope of his calling for our life and the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe, that God will give us a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. He said that I count all things but dung for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ. So the more we are aware that is in us, of course, and that is not just in us, but is very mighty in us. Examine yourself as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourself. Do you not know yourself that Jesus Christ is in you? What a question. Don't you know that Jesus Christ is in you? Because that's how we are the aroma of Christ. We are his living temple, is the bread of life. Yes, Romans chapter 8. But you are not in the flesh, but in the spirit, if indeed the spirit of God dwells in you. And now, if anyone does not have the spirit of Christ, he is not his. And if Christ is in you, of course, the body is dead. And so you could imagine that here is the picture where we are being revealed that Christ is very much living in us, the believers. It's just to the measure of how much we believe that is in there. The more we are aware, the more, of course, the greater our worship, the greater the part of even our prayer, because we just know that the Lord is an indwelling Savior in us today. It's not just a distant God. That's why I say, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. So some other scripture: set your mind on things above and not things on the earth. Colossians chapter 3, for you died and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life. So it's our very life today, is the life of God. So it's our very life and existence. It's the element in our life. An element is the constitution, the inward being of a thing. So the element of an orange fruit is the juice. And that is actually the reason why people are buying the juice, buying the fruits. You buy the fruits for the juice. You don't buy the fruits. Basically, not many people buy the fruits because they want the peel or the seed or the pulp. They want the very juice, because that's where the greater nutrient is. So our element as believers is Christ, is our element, is our sphere as well. So Christ, who is our life, so is our life today as well. So looking ahead, at that day you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. John chapter 14. So here was his valedictory talk with the disciples, that he was going, but he was coming back again. So he said, in that day you will know that I am in my Father and you in me and I in you. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us, that he is very much in us today. Wherever we go, we know we have the very presence of God with us. Also, I will not leave you orphans, I will come to you. That is, we are not going to be helpless. He's not going to leave us in an helpless state. That he said it as well, that he was going to die, but it was to our own advantage that he goes. Because if he doesn't go, he can't come back in another form. And that's the joy we have today, that Christ in us, the hope of glory. So because I live, you will live also. This brings joy to our hearts. This is almost, you want to call it, this great treasure we have. That what we have, this treasure in us, that the excellency of the power may be of God. This treasure in earthen vessel, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will seek my word, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him. Also, and we will come to him and make our home with him. We will come to him and make our home with him. What a joy. That is, like anyone that keeps his word, the Lord is saying that they will come to us and make their home with us. What a joy for what the Lord is doing. So Jesus said that if anyone loves me, there's no way you will love someone that you are not even aware that it did something for you. So that's why as we grow in the knowledge of God, we grow in the knowledge of Christ, we are more aware of what he has done for us and what he's actually even doing for us till date, and also what he's going to do for us in eternity future. So we are just full of joy. We cannot help but just to love him because of what a lot of things. So the more we grow in knowledge, the greater our love towards him. And he says that, and we will keep his word, and the Father will love us, and they will come and make their home in us. Where are they going to make their home in us? In our very heart. What a joy for what the Lord is doing. Abide in me and I in you. That is, dwell in me, remain in me, make me your home. Then I will make you my home. And someone might ask that, how do I make the Lord my home? Or how does the Lord make himself? He said, as my word abide in you. And so the more we have the word of God dwelling in us, because Christ is the word of God, is the word of God from eternity past to eternity future. He said, in the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. So he who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. So, for without me you can do nothing. And of course, the ultimate goal of God creating us is to be fruitful. And being fruitful, in my own opinion, I think is meaning that from what I learned even from Genesis chapter 1, the original Hebrew context, is mean being productive. That is being productive, that when God made man in Genesis, when he said, be fruitful, multiply. And so that is to be productive in whatever area of calling he has called us. He has all called us to different sides, different spheres of life that will add value to humanity. And for us to be fruitful in any sphere he has called us to be productive, it means that he has to be the one working in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. We can't be fruitful except it is Christ in us who is actually working and doing. That's why I said, if you don't abide in me and I in you, you think you are bearing fruit, but it's just almost like going through, you're just on the same spot, just like in a treadmill. You're not moving any distance, you're not making any progress, I mean, physically. But so you can see that our fruitfulness is in our abiding in Christ, because he's the very one that makes our life to be very fruitful. And I have declared to them, this is his prayer in John chapter 17, when he was rounding up, in most quarters is believed to be the greatest prayer in the Bible. That's John chapter 17, where God on the flesh was praying to the Father God. And I have declared to them your name, and we declare, look at his ultimate, his greatest joy, and what he used to round up the prayer, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them and I in them. So his goal was to get into our heart. That's why we said the heart of man is the destination of Christ. Our human heart is his destination. He wanted to come into us. And that's why what a joy, what he prayed for, we are actually a reality. We are living in reality of it today, because by coming into us, he regenerates us and is transforming us. And so here's Galatians chapter 1. But when he pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles. That is the ultimate goal. The great goal of God for us as saints is to continue to reveal the Son of God in us. And this is a daily experience, as much time that we allow God to do it, because we can't preach him, we can't preach could mean minister. That is because we are containers of Christ as believers. It doesn't mean that you have his physical altar, but in any walk of life, the Lord has called you in any area of human endeavor, whether as an engineer, as a lawyer, as a, in what a real estate, in the government house, in politics, in judiciary, in whatever arm, or even in the church, in the ministry, God is saying that he is actually, we are supposed to be the aroma of Christ. We are supposed to be ministering Christ in every sphere. There's darkness everywhere. So we are the ones that carry the light of the world to spread the light everywhere. And Paul is saying that God to and this revelation of Christ has to be continuous, the more, because it's infinite. So the more of him we know, the more we can minister him in every sphere of human endeavor. And in Galatians chapter 2, he said, but I have been crucified with Christ, it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. That is, as believers, what makes us different from every other creature on the surface of the earth is that Christ is living in us. We should give him the opportunity. We should increase, we should allow him to increase his dominion over every part of our being. He says he stands at the door and knocks. He doesn't want to force himself on us, but what a joy, the privilege we have that we are creatures, not just in the image and likeness of God, but we are creatures that are in the image and likeness of God. And in addition, we have the very life of God in us. And the life of God is not separate from God. That is God himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. So, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God. That is, in everything we do, it should not just be I, the old I, but the new I. The old I is the I in Adam. There are about five I's here. This is one. This is two. This is three. I think there were five. And if you use me as well, because I was referring to me as well, to me. So about four or five different. There's the old I, which is the I that was in Adam, and same for all. And there's the I that is in Christ. So the I that is dead, that is still trying to live, that's the flesh, if you want to put it that way. And the I that's as well, the regenerated spirit, that is one spirit with the Lord. What a joy for what the Lord is doing in our life, the new I in Christ. My little children, for whom I labor in birth again, until Christ is formed in you. So this is the joy, this is the travail of the servant of God, of the of Paul, which I think for us as ministers of God in any walk of life where we are at as believers, we are reconciling the world back to God. So God is saying that we need to be travailing in bad things until Christ is formed in the heart of the people. That's the goal God brings. That's why that's, to me, I think that's a major priority, why God brings people to the church. That's why God brings anybody, that Christ will be formed in there. The moment Christ is formed in there, they will reflect Christ anywhere they go to. They will be conscious of heaven. They will not They will be the embodiment of Christ in any environment. And of course, we don't really have to tell them much about ethics, why they should not fight, why they should not steal, because Christ is the one living in them. Christ has been formed. But if Christ has not been formed in them, it's still the old I, the old Adamic nature and the flesh that might still be taking preeminence. And I pray that will not be our portion in Jesus' name. And here is John chapter 10. I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly. That is to become our very life. He came to be our life. Here's 1 Corinthians 6:17, that For he who is joined to the Lord is one spirit in him. So in this new I, in this Christ in the heart, then we are one spirit with the Lord. What a joy that now the Lord is the Spirit. Now the Lord is the Spirit. The Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Grace be with you. Amen. 2 Timothy chapter 4, I think verse 22. So that the Lord Jesus Christ be with our spirit. And why is he with us? Why is he one spirit with us? He's one spirit with us to carry out God's organic salvation, which we'll go to, I think, in two or three few pages from here. So the Lord is the Spirit to live inside of us so that he could express himself, he could manifest himself through our life. That's why we are called the vessels of God. We are vessels because we are carrying a treasure that is beyond what any human can ever imagine, that we are one spirit with the Lord. That what a joy to just worship that Lord as we are going out today. Be one spirit with us. Be the one speaking through me. Be the one acting through me. When people see me, when they see anything regarding me, let it be Christ. Let it be you they are seeing, so that our world will be seasoned with grace. I think that's a joy for us as believers, that we are the fragrance of Christ. We are the aroma of Christ in every environment. We are the living epistles of Christ because we are one spirit with the Lord. Reading ahead, Christ on the cross accomplished God's judicial redemption. So on the cross, he accomplished God's judicial redemption, which involves deliverance from the kingdom of darkness, forgiveness of sin, reconciliation to God, and justification. So on the cross, this was the key part, we could say, and you could see an account of this in the four gospels, what he was doing on the cross of Calvary. And I didn't go into the ministry of the Lord, the human ministry, where he was teaching, doing miracles and signs. We just left that to the, we wanted to just narrow on what we were looking at today. Christ on the cross, these are the things. He destroyed the devil through his death. Hebrews chapter 2, I think verse 10. The forgiveness of sin as the Aaronic order of priesthood. The Alpha sacrifice became the ultimate sacrifice for the redemption of man. He reconciled us back to God by his blood in Romans chapter 5, and justification, we are now justified. Justification basically is like God not imputing the penalty of Adam upon us, that we are now made right with him through the substitutionary sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ. So let's look at what Christ in the heart is doing. So Christ in the heart is accomplishing God's organic salvation. And what God's organic salvation is, basically to walk himself into these believers, his children, so that we will be his expression anywhere we go to. But this involves a lot of different stages and processes. Regeneration, which is we receiving the life of God into our human life. In addition to our human life, we receive the divine life of God into our spirit man. Is being reborn, is being rebirthed. And because we had two births, there's a birth in Adam and birth in Christ, that whatever is born of the flesh is flesh, and which that is born of the spirit is spirit. So there's sanctification, where the Lord, by living in our heart, is sanctifying us by his truth, separating us from that which is worldly and commonly. The renewal of the mind, Romans 12, that we be renewed in our mind. Our mind is of the old creation. Now it needs to be renewed with the word of God, so that it will pattern itself after the mind of Christ. The transformation, that is like as we behold him as in a glass, we have been transformed from glory to glory. That is, as the word is working in us, we have been transformed to the point whereby we are reflecting the glory of Christ in every environment we find ourselves. And now we are also conformed to the image of Christ, which is part of his ultimate goal, that we will be conformed to his glorious image. And the glorification, Romans chapter 8. So you can see it, because these are all this building work. So we can look at the Christ work on the cross as the redemption. Now from there, we have his organic work, which is building, whereby he's building us from the inside out, so that every part of our character, our nature, our old Adamic nature, is transforming it to pattern after the new man in himself. What a joy for what the Lord is doing. So Christ is not only in our heart, he's also in our, he has also put us into himself. He's not just in our hearts alone. He has put us into his very self. He said, abide in me and I in you. That is a mutual abode. He said, this is a mutual abiding, a coherence union where two parties, two or more parties are living in one another. This is humanly impossible. This coherence, it's been taken away from the English dictionary centuries ago because they didn't understand what it meant. Of course, the church fathers, they knew what coherence means. It's like when two different parties are living in one another. And we think the only picture, the only definition of this is what happens in the divine trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, where they are living in one another. I mean the Father, and the Father is in me. So it's a very mysterious union, and that's the union that he has brought us into himself. That's why he said, abide in me and I in you. In that day you will know I am in my Father, and I in you, and you in me. You in me, I in you, I in them. He kept on saying it because it's a coherence union, because we are not just in him, he's also in us. So he becomes our element and our sphere. What a joy for what the Lord is doing in our life. So many are still focused on the Christ on the cross, and it disappears. It's like, oh, the Christ on the cross. And the Lord is saying that, hey, yes, we thank God for the cross, we are eulogizing for it, but much more important is what he's doing in our hearts today. So appears he has changed his address from the cross to the hearts. That's why I said, why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but he's risen. He's no longer on the cross physically, but he's actually in our hearts, our altar, whereby we worship and serve the Lord. So he also said, he who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. So this is John chapter 6. As the living Father sent me, and I live by the Father, so whoever feeds on me will live by me. So the more we feed on him, the more he's able to express himself through our life. Say, whoever feeds on him, he will live in us. So the more we eat him, the more we fellowship with him. And that's why in the book of Acts, they realize that the boldness that Peter and the other disciples, that they realize that they have been with Jesus. So that's the joy we have today. 1 Corinthians 1:9 says that God is faithful, who has called us unto fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ. So you can see that we've been called unto the fellowship of God, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, so that they could live in us and express themselves through our life. What a joy for what. Just to round up in summary, earlier we talked about the cross represent the work of Christ for us. The heart represent the work of Christ in us. The cross is God word. The heart is man word. So the cross was related to what the Lord did to reconcile us to God. The heart is man word. We are the focus in this time. Also, we said both places are altars, that the heart is a receptacle for Christ, and the cross is the cross and the heart are altars. So these are great altars. That's why I said that a good man out of the treasure stored, the good treasure stored in his heart brings forth good fruit, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth that which is evil. So he is the very treasure, because this treasure, for we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. So you can see how much that we are a mobile altar of the Lord, and what a joy. And so the heaven is wherever Christ is. Heaven, in my opinion, is wherever Christ is. His presence in the heart makes heaven in the heart. For behold, the kingdom of heaven is within you. From Luke 17, I think verse 20-21. So for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. So today we've been able to look at Christ on the cross and Christ in the heart. We said that these are two critical ministries of the Lord. The work of the Christ on the cross represents the work of Christ for us, and Christ in the heart represents the work of Christ today in us. From the history Christ to the present Christ, from the last Adam to the life-giving Spirit. And we looked at different stages that we have: Christ from eternity past, Christ, the incarnated Christ who became flesh, the Christ, the crucified Christ, the resurrected Christ, the ascended Christ, that's the glorified Christ that is on the throne. And we said that Christ on the cross, we have him as the Lamb of God, the seed of the woman, the only begotten Son of God, Christ in the four Gospels, the brazen serpent in form of serpents, and because we had to be there to be able to destroy the devil. Also the Christ in the heart, the great, our great high priest, the life-giving Spirit, the second man, the head of the new creation, and on the Christ from Acts to or Revelation to the eternity past, that's the Spirit of Christ who is in us. We said that also, that we looked at a lot of scriptures, Ephesians chapter 3, that Christ may make his home in our hearts. Also, we looked at Colossians 1, that Christ in us, the hope of glory, Christ who is our life, that Christ being revealed in us, Christ living in us, Christ being formed in us, and the heart of man, we said, is the receptacle for to receive Christ. We said that our hearts and the cross are two great altars. So we have the cross, the altar of the cross, which redeemed us to God, and the altar of our hearts today, where Christ is dwelling. We say Christ on the cross delivered us from Egypt, and this now, and Christ in our heart is bringing us from the kingdom of Christ on the heart. Christ in our heart is bringing us into the promised land, which is the holiest of all, the very presence of God, where we are dwelling in today. So our heart is very sacred. That is where God dwells in us today. What a joy for what the Lord has done for us. So we are full of praises, we are full of thanksgiving and appreciation of what the Lord has done. Hallelujah to the Christ on the cross. Hallelujah to the Christ in our heart. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.